Hello, good day viewers. You are welcome to my YouTube channel. This is Chemistry Hangout. Today we are going to be looking at one of the most important topics in chemistry. Okay, so I want us to pay maximum attention. If you are just watching this YouTube channel for the first time, I want you to actually subscribe to this channel. You can use the comment box to actually comment. You can like the video, you can share, and I'm promising you that we will give you nothing but the best on this channel. You are welcome once again to another chemistry section today. I want to believe we are doing fine. Okay, today very quickly we are going to be looking at a very important topic in chemistry. But before we actually look at that topic, I will ask a question and I'll give an illustration. And I'll start by saying, most of the things we do, or one of the things we do as humans, is we make friends. Of course, you know, loneliness is not good. Okay, so the reason why we make friends is you want to have somebody to chat with, you want to have somebody to catch fun with, you want to have somebody to relate with. You get that now? That's the reason why we make friends. You agree with me that when we begin to make friends, we get so intimate, we get so close, that we form a bond. We form a bond to an extent that, you know, you call the person every day, you want to hear about the person, you want to see how the person is actually feeling. So the intimacy comes in because we have actually formed friends. And from that very particular intimacy, we begin to form a bond, which makes us to be very, very close. So we can refer to that as a friendship bond, okay? Because we are friends and we are very intimate, we get to form what we call a friendship bond. So also, the way we do it in our day-to-day activities, in chemistry too, it is possible for you to form a friendship bond. But in chemistry, we don't refer to it as friendship bond. We refer to it as chemical bond. Because our atoms too, they tend to want to interact with each other. They tend to want to be intimate with each other to a point that they become very close to each other. So when they become very close to each other, we say they are formed bonds. But now, the friendship bond that we refer to it in our day-to-day activity is not so in chemistry, we call it chemical bond. So today, we're going to be talking about chemical bonds. We're going to be looking extensively about chemical bonds. So, very, very important, our atoms too, they tend to form bonds with each other. How? They interact with each other to actually form bonds. They become so close to an extent that they become so intimate, and by so doing, they form bonds with each other. So, an extension of the friendship bonds we form in our day-to-day activities is what chemistry refers to as chemical bond. So if you want to know how to keep friends, you need to understand chemistry. If you want to know how to keep friends, you need to understand chemistry, because in chemistry, we understand what it takes to be bonded together. You understand what it takes to be intimate. Okay, so for you to understand how to be intimate or how to keep friends, how to bond with them, relate with them, interact with them, you need to understand chemical bonds. And that's why this topic is very, very important. Not in chemistry, but in our day-to-day activity. So you are welcome once again to this wonderful chemistry section on this channel. And we're going to be looking at chemical bonds. Now, the question is this. I told us that atoms in chemistry, they tend to form bonds. Why do they form bonds? That is the first question we are going to be asking. Why do they form bonds? I've said that when I was using humans as an example, that we form bonds because we want to have somebody to chat with, we want to have somebody to relate with, we want to have somebody to be intimate with. So also in chemistry, atoms form bonds for them to be stable. Because most of those atoms are unstable. Why are they unstable? We're going to talk about that. But the reason why chemical bonds are formed in chemistry is because they want to attain, those atoms want to attain stability. I have done electric configuration in one of my videos on this channel. If you have not actually watched it, you can check the videos, you see electronic configuration of atoms. And that explains why some atoms are not actually stable. If you have not forgotten, you know, in our electronic configuration, our K shell can contain maximum number of 2 electrons, okay? Our L share can contain maximum number of 8 electrons. Our N can contain maximum number of 18. Our N can contain maximum number of 32. And that's the reason why likes of hydrogen has an electronic configuration 1, okay? Helium has 2, lithium has 2, 1, going by the electronic configuration using our shell. You know, sodium has 2, 8, 1, magnesium has 2, 8, 2, aluminium has 2, 8, 3, you see, calcium has 2, 8, 8, 2. Do we understand that now? Helium, we have done that. Neon has 2, 8, because this is atomic number 10, this will be 20. This will be 13, this 12, 11, this 3, this 2, and this 1. Now, only from this electronic configuration, we can tell if an atom is stable or not. Let's take for example. Look at hydrogen. Hydrogen has only one electron. And the number of electrons that should be in the first shell is 2. But hydrogen has one. Meaning, hydrogen is not stable. Which means hydrogen needs to interact with other atoms for it to be stable, and that is where chemical bond. That interaction between other atoms to be stable is where chemical bonds is being formed. I hope you are following. So, for helium now, if you look at helium, it has only one shell, and if you agree with me, this will be 2, okay? And the first shell will take maximum number of 2, meaning helium is stable. Can you see that? Lithium is not stable. Sodium is not stable. Magnesium, not stable. Aluminium, not stable. Because they have not complete their octet structure. Calcium, not stable. But neon, look at it. The first shell, 2, that's 2. The second shell, 8, is at, it has 8, so it is stable. So all other atoms in the periodic table, they want to behave like these ones that are stable. And the only solution for them to actually attain stability is to interact with other atoms or their kind of atoms to actually form. So when they interact with themselves, atoms like themselves or other atoms that are different from themselves, they tend to form chemical bonds. I hope you are following. So the reason why chemical bond comes in place is to solve the instability of atom. Okay? Is to solve the instability of atom. So when they interact with themselves, they become stable. So for all these interactions, interactions between atoms of the same element or different elements can result in different type of bonds, which are number one, we can have what we call the electrovalent or the ionic bond, okay? We can have two, we can have the covalent bond, okay? We can have three, we can have the coordinate, covalent or dative bond, okay? You can have four, you can have metallic bond, you can have metallic bond, okay? You can have five, you can have hydrogen bond. And hydrogen bond, then six, you can have the van der Waal force. Van der Waal force, okay? So, in the quest of our atoms trying to be stable, they tend to form different kinds of bonds. And the bonds could be either electrovalent or ionic. The bonds could be either covalent bond. The bond could be coordinate covalent or dative. The bond could be metallic. The bond could be hydrogen. The bond could be van der Waal force. Okay. There are some that are not really bonds like that. When we get to other type of bond, I will explain that. But let's start and see. How do I know if a particular bond is electrovalent bond? When I see a compound being formed, or when I see atoms interacting with themselves, how do I know it is electrovalent bond? Let's see. So let's take number one. Then we have electrovalent. Electrovalent or ionic bond. Now, from the word, from this very particular word, electrovalent. Valent is from the word valence. Okay? Electro is from the word electro. Which means this very particular one has something to do with valence electron. And what do we mean by valence electron? You are talking about the electron that is at the outermost shell of an atom. Which means for this one to be successful, you have something to do with the electron that is at the atmosphere of an atom. Let's take examples. Number one example, we have this compound. This is sodium chloride. This is sodium chloride. What is the kind of bond that exists between this? And don't forget, when you talk about electrovalent bond, very, very important, we are talking about transfer of electrons. Electrons are being transferred in electrovalent bond. Let's take an example. We have sodium chloride. Sodium has atomic number 11, and that is 281, okay? Chlorine has an atomic number 17, that is 287. I hope you are following. I will draw the diagrammatic representation of this. So for other subsequent one, I might not draw it, but let me draw the diagrammatic representation of this. Now, this very particular combination is before combination. Before they combine, they are not stable. Why? If you look at this one, it has not complete its outer structure. You have one here. It still needs some more electrons for it to be stable. This has seven. Still needs more for it to be stable. So before combination, this is their state. They are not stable. And don't forget, the reason why chemical bonds are being formed is because those atoms want to attain stability. So from here, drawing the diagrammatic representation of this, I have two. Okay, I have eight. I have eight here, and I have one here. I hope I'm following. That's for sodium. Now I have two, eight, and seven. So this is two. This is eight. And this is seven. Now, what happens in electrovalent bond? Don't forget, we said electron and valence. This is the valence electron here, one. That's the valence electron here, seven. So it is easier for one to be transferred to seven. So this one here is being transferred. One, two, three, four. That's seven. Okay? So this one here is being transferred to this. Can you see that now? When this one here is being transferred to this, you know this was sodium before, 281. Now the one is being transferred, it becomes this. Can you see? The reason why it's carrying a positive charge now is because one electron is being transferred. I have said that several on this channel. When you collect electron in chemistry, you become negatively charged. When you give electron, you become positively charged. So this gives electron. How many electron? One. That's why it's carrying plus. To form what? A cation. Because when you are positively charged, you're a cation. Okay? Now, this is collecting one. That's chlorine. It's collecting one now. Chlorine. Chloride ion. It's collecting one now. So when it collects one, it becomes an ester. That's the reason why we said electrovalent bond or ionic bond is transfer of electron. One is transferred to this. So from there, this is in the ionic state. Now that's the reason why we said ionic. We said ionic bond. Because when electron is being transferred, they become polar. What do we mean by polar? They have this positive charge and negative charge. This becomes positively charged. This becomes negatively charged. Thereby forming an ion, sodium ion, chloride ion. I hope you are following me. So with this now, this kind of bond, this kind of interaction now is our electrovalent bond. Why? Because it involves transfer of electron. And that's the reason why there's a difference between this and this. There's a difference between this and this. This is 281 when it does not combine. Why this is 28? Can we see that? So this sodium atom, this is sodium ion. It becomes an ion after it has given electron. So this becomes this chlorine atom and this chloride ion. Different. This 287 and this 288. So from this now, we can conclude that, of course, it is the formation of the bonds that brought about the name. Because one, we use the valence electron, that is the electron outside the shell, to actually form the bond. And after using it, they become an ion. And that's the reason why they are either electrovalent or ion. So after combination, now, what happens? It becomes this. When they combine now, it becomes this. Very stable. Because this is 2,8, complete, very stable. This is 288, very stable. So, and that is the reason why they form bonds. Don't forget, they want to be stable. That's the reason why they are forming bonds. So, the kind of bond with sodium chloride here is what is an electrovalent bond. I hope you are following. Let's take other examples. Let's take Another example, let's take magnesium chloride as another example. Magnesium is atomic number 12, okay? So we have 2, 8, 2. I hope you are following. Now, chlorine, now if you look at this very compound, you have two chlorines here. So maybe one of the chlorine has atomic number 17, which is 2, 8, 7. And another chlorine, because there are two, is also 2, 8, 7. What happens? This is not stable, this is not stable, this is not stable. Okay, this is before combination. This is before. This is before combination. This is the state. After combination, what happens? One electron is transferred to this place to become 8, okay? It will be remaining one there, be transferred to this one to become 8. So after combination, what happens? This has given magnesium now. Has given how many? It has given the total number of 2 electrons. So it carries positive charge, 2 plus, because it has given 1. The chlorine that you have here, you have chlorine here, okay? The chlorine, you have 2 chlorine. They have collected 1 each, but the number, the total number of electrons they collected is 2, but each of them collected 1, which makes them to be what? To have this very particular ion, or to have this charge, that's a chloride ion. So from this now, after they are combined, this becomes 2, 8 stable. This becomes 2, 8, 8 stable. I hope you are following. And don't forget, because it is ionic, it forms positive and what a negative end. I hope you are following now. So for you to understand, for you to even at mere looking at a particular compound with the electronic configuration, you can quickly deduce, for example sake, you can quickly deduce that that is the electronic configuration if it is electrovalent. You can quickly deduce because electrons will be transferred, okay? And when electron is transferred, it means the kind of bond we are actually talking about is what? Is electrovalent bond. And one of the things that will help you, to understand what we call valency is this chemical combination. Because valency is talking about the combining power of an atom. And what is your combining power? Your combining power is most times the number of electrons you can give at a go, or the number of electrons you can collect at a go. Like magnesium now, I can say the combining power of magnesium is 2 plus, which is its valency. Why? Because the maximum number of electrons magnesium can give is 2. Can we see that? And if you really understand this chemical bonding, it leads you to understanding valency. And if you understand valency, naming compounds or writing the names of compounds will not give you problem. So I want us to really pay attention to this class so that we can get some rudiments in chemistry to help us in our further studies to actually enjoy the subject. So this, now, the valency of magnesium here is plus 2. The valency of chlorine is minus 2. Can you see that now? Very, very important. Let's take another example. Let's take calcium oxide. You know some of us that have actually studied chemistry or did chemistry, especially students, when they ask you, write aluminum oxide, you'll be finding it difficult. You'll be finding it difficult to write the molecular formula of aluminum oxide. The reason is because you don't understand your chemical combination and you don't understand valency. When you understand chemical combination, definitely you understand valency. And when you understand valency, you can write the names of some simple inorganic. Okay. Now look at this, calcium oxide, what kind of bond do you have here? The first thing I do is my electronic configuration, that's the key to chemical bonding. Calcium is atomic number 20, I have 2, 8, 8, 2. Can we see that? Oxygen is atomic number 8, I have 2, 6. Very easy. With this, I will know 2 will be transferred to this so that it will be complete. Can you see that? So calcium, we carry the plus 2. Why? Because it has given 2. Why oxygen that collected the 2? We carry the 2 minus because it has collected the 2. Can we see that now? So the kind of bond that involves transfer is always electrovalent bond, which means this will now be 2, 8, 8 stable. This will now be 2, 8 stable. Can we see that? So at near constructing the electronic configuration, with construction of electronic configuration, you will actually understand if the electron will be transferred or it will not be transferred. So I hope you can try this on your own. You can try this on your own. Other further examples, you can try aluminium oxide on your own. See that, you can try that on your own. That would be number four. You can try that on your own. Okay, you can try compounds like calcium chloride on your own. You can try all these compounds on your own to see how electron is being transferred. So don't forget, if electron is being transferred in chemical bonding, the kind of bond that is always formed will be electrovalent or ionic bond. And some of the characteristics, when you have electrovalent bonds, forms like that, they have their characteristics. Like all these compounds, that kind of bond between them and electrovalent bonds, they have their characteristics. And one of the characteristics is that they are always soluble in water. Yes, most of those compounds are soluble in water because of their polar nature. Because they are polar. What do you mean by polar? They are positive and negative. So they tend to be soluble in water. Number two, most of them, they are solid at room temperature. You know, they are solid at room temperature. All those compounds that are listed in their ordinary state, in their normal condition, they are solid at room temperature. Their normal salt at home, which is sodium chloride, is solid at room temperature. So you can have them. Three, they are good conductors of heat and electricity. They are good conductors of heat and electricity. And good conductors of heat and electricity. Why are they able to conduct electricity? Because of their polar nature. You know, you have a positive end, you have a negative end. And because they have a positive and a negative end, definitely they'll be able to conduct electricity. Why don't we just do the last one? They have high melting and boiling point. They have high melting and boiling point. Yeah. They have high melting and boiling point because they are the kind of bonds between them is electrovalent bonds. So electrovalent bonds will form electrovalent compounds, and electrovalent compounds have high melting point. I hope I've told you. So that is that for electrovalent or ionic bonding. Very, very quickly, don't forget they have transfer of electrons. Electrons are always transferred. Electrons are always transferred. I hope we are following. So we can try all those examples on our own to see how the electron is being transferred from one atom to another. So very quickly, let's see covalent bond now. Let's see covalent bond. That's another type of bond that might be formed between covalent bond. Okay, now for covalent bond, don't forget we said for electrovalent bond, it involves the transfer of electron, transfer of electron. But for covalent bond, it deals with sharing of electrons. Please pay attention to this. It involves sharing of electrons. Electrons are not transferred in covalent bonds. Electrons are shared in covalent bonds. On one condition. And what is the condition? The two participating atoms must be a donor. If you want to share electrons, you want to share my food with me, you must bring your own food. I'll bring my own food. We'll now join the two food together to eat it. You get that now? Because, you know, sharing are of two types. It is possible for you to be the owner of the food and another person comes and share the food with you, which means eating the food with you. That's one type of sharing. Another type of sharing is you brought a particular food, I brought particular food, you join them together, they will share. So in covalent bond now, the kind of, for them to be able to share electron, it is on one condition. The two of you that want to share must bring the same number of electron. If you are bringing one, I will bring one. If you are bringing two, I will bring two. If you have four, I will bring four too, for us to be complete. If you need two, if the total number of electron we need is two, you will bring one, I will bring one. And that is the kind of sharing here. So the two participating atoms must donate electron. Let's see examples. Example one, hydrogen gas. Look at this. This is an hydrogen gas. Two molecules of hydrogen. You have two atoms of hydrogen here forming a molecule of hydrogen. How is that formed? hydrogen has atomic number one, okay? You have two hydrogen there. The two are not stable because you have two hydrogen in this molecule, two hydrogen atom in this molecule. With electronic configuration 1-1, they are not stable. They needed to be stable. If this one give this one, you will not be having anything again. If this one give this one, you will not be having anything again. You are even complicating the issue. So what do? They share. So this one has one, this one has one. Have you seen that now? So what happens? They share the electron. This one come and say, okay, this is my one electron. And this one come and say, okay, let me form bond with you and give you my one electron. So we share. So this very particular sharing is what we call covalent. I hope you're following. Let's see that a share. So when we share electron, you know we are actually participating or we are actually doing covalent bonding. Okay. Let's take example two. We have chlorine. Can we see that now? Chlorine gas. You know in chlorine, you have two atoms of chlorine, each with atomic number 17. So you have 2, 8, 7. You have 2, 8, 7. I hope you're following. If look at this, even here looking at it, we know the sharing will not work. Because if this one should give this one one, this one will be complete, but this one will be six. Meaning this one is not still stable, despite that it is giving electron. If this one should give this one one, this one will be remaining six, and this one will be stable. Meaning this one is not still stable. So for the two of them to be stable, they share. How? Because we say chlorine 2, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 7. Then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. I hope you're following. Then we have the second one, 2. We have another one, 8. Okay, and we have the third shell now, which is 7. So here now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Can you see that now? So if you count all the electrons that are here, it is 8 for this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You count the one for this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Don't forget the condition. This one brought one. This one brought one. And that's why we are able to share. And we are following. So, in covalent bond, we don't transfer. We share. But on one condition, the number of electrons I'm bringing must be the same with the number of electrons you are attracting. I hope you are following. Let's take another example. Let's see methane. Let's see methane. Okay, let's see. It's kind of bond here. If you look at this now, you have carbon here, which is 2, 4. And you have four hydrogens. You have four hydrogens. You have hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, hydrogen 3, and hydrogen 4. Because you have four hydrogens here. If you look at this, if all these hydrogens combine their electron to give to carbon, it will be injustice. It will be injustice. Because they will not still be stable. Because they won't even have any shell again. And they needed 1, 1, 1, 1. Of course, carbon 2 cannot give them. Because they have 1, 1, 1, 1. Carbon cannot be giving them 1, 1, 1. It is not comfortable for carbon. Okay? It is not comfortable for carbon. So what will carbon do? It tends to share with hydrogen. How? You have carbon that's 2, okay? And 4 electrons now. You have 1, 2, 3, 4. I hope you are following now. So each hydrogen will come and share. Don't forget, if you are bringing one and bringing one, that's the condition for covalent bond. So this hydrogen will come here, bring in, bring one. This hydrogen to come here, bring one. This hydrogen to come here, bring one. This hydrogen to come here, bring one. Can you see that now? So with that, everybody is stable. Hydrogen here, 2, 2, 2, 2. Why? Carbon has completed its octet structure. So this is covalent. I hope we are actually following. Let's have other examples. Let's have other examples in my head. Let's have water. Let's see the bonds in water. Now, when we look at this, oxygen, that's 2, 6. And you have 2 hydrogen here, which is 1 and 1. These 2 hydrogen cannot give oxygen their 2. Because the 2, they need 1 and 1. Because they're supposed to be 2. They have 1 shell. The number of electrons that is there supposed to be 2, 2. So they cannot give hydrogen, they cannot give oxygen. They are 2. It's not possible. They cannot give oxygen. Because if they give oxygen, they will not even be having any shell again and any electron. And oxygen 2 cannot give them 1, 1. Because if oxygen give 1, 1, it will be remaining 4 years. Oxygen is not stable. So transfer will not work for them. what we want for them, they share. Now, if you look at this, passage, that will be 2, 6, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Help me for me. So, identity become bring and share. Identity become. Identity cannot come here. And I will explain why. The reason why identity cannot come here is because this is 2 electrons. Identity is bringing 1. Don't forget the condition. The condition is that if you bring 1, I bring 1. That's the only way. That's the only condition for us to be able to share. Help me get it. So, identity gives this 1 1, share. Identity gives this 1 1, share. And it is balanced. And that's the reason why, if you look at this, we used to call them a bond pair. Very important. I want us to take note of that. So they are bonding together. Everything is bringing its shell and bringing one electron to bond with the shell of oxygen. We used to call them bond pair. Okay? These are bond pair. This 1, 2 is bond pair. Okay? But if you look at these two electrons, nobody is coming to meet them. They are just free. We call them lone pair. From the word lonely. They are lonely. Nobody is forming bond with them. So this is lone pair. This also is lone. Can we see that? So the one that they are forming bond with this hydrogen forming bond with one electron of oxygen, forming bond with one electron of oxygen. That's why we are calling them bond pair. But these two, they are not. So these are not good examples of covalent bond. We are actually sharing. I hope you are following. Let's take one other example, then I'll give us further examples for us to study for our leisure time. We have ammonia, NH2. So for nitrogen, that's 2, 5, that's atomic number 7, and for hydrogen we have 1, hydrogen we have 2, hydrogen we have 3, because we have 3 atoms of hydrogen here. Look at it, hydrogen cannot continue to give their 1, because hydrogen will not be comfortable. Hydrogen needs 1 also. If hydrogen should give it 1, it will not even be adding anything again. So hydrogen cannot give it 1. Okay? And nitrogen too is not ready to give them 1, 1, 1. Because if it gives them 1, 1, that's 3. Minus 3, that will be 2. It's not stable again. It's not stable. Despite it's giving electrons, it's not stable again. So what is the shape? And nitrogen, that will be 2. Then we'll be having 5. Okay? We have 1, 2. Why? Because hydrogen will be coming to give this 1, hydrogen will be coming to give this 1, hydrogen will be coming to give this 1. Don't forget what I call that. These are what are bond pair. These 3, 1, 2, 3, they are all bond pair. Why? Because they are bonding with an electron of nitrogen. Why this one that is lonely is what we call lonely. Correct. So, these are examples of covalent bonds, you know, hydrogen gas, chlorine gas, methane, water, and ammonia are good examples of covalent bonds. We can try others to ourselves. We have other examples of covalent bonds at our present. You can try that, you know, can do for nitrogen, can do for fluorine, okay, can do for a whole lot of compounds like that, can do for nitrogen, yes, can do for fluorine, so very, very important. You can have all these ones. You can try these two on your own. No, this is also equivalent. You can try that on your own. No, you can try these two. Yes, you can try these two. That's it. You can just try that on your own to see how they are actually bonded. Okay, you can try that on your own and leave a comment in the comment section to actually see if you have actually been able to lay your hands on them. So we have a whole lot of examples. We have a whole lot of examples of covalent compounds. These are few examples of them. So don't forget sharing of electron or one condition. The number of electrons you are bringing, the number of electrons I'm bringing will be the same for us to actually be able to share. Okay. That's that for covalent bond. Let's move to coordinate orbital bonding. Now, the coordinate orbital bonding too is an extension of covalent bonding. It involves sharing. Okay, let's add that. Coordinate orbital coordinate auditive. So our coordinate auditive is an extension of covalent bond two, but under one condition. The condition is that you don't need to bring electron. You don't need to bring electron. It's either there is electron there for you, bring your shell, or there is shell for you, bring your electron. Can you see that now? Not unlike your covalent bonds that you must bring your electron, the number of electrons you must bring and the one I'm bringing will be the same. But in your coordinate covalent bond, it's only one person that will be bringing the electron. What you need is, don't just bring your shell. It's a good example of, you know, I want to give you food. You don't need to bring your food. You want to share my food with me. You don't need to bring your food. Just bring your spoon. So just bring your spoon. The food is just there for you to eat. And that's an example of coordinate dating. You know, I used an example of you having your own food, me having my own food. You are mixing it together and we are eating it. That's covalent bond, okay? But your coordinate covalent bond is no. You want to share my food with me, that's fine. I'm a cheerful giver. You don't need to bring your food, just bring your spoon. That is your coordinate or dating bond. Let's see an example. Let's see two good examples. We have H3O plus. We call it hydrozonium. Please allow us to pay attention to this. We call it hydrozonium ion. Let's really explain that. Now, our hydrozonium ion, how is our hydrozonium ion formed? That's where I'll start from. Our hydrozonium ion is formed from our water molecules plus hydrogen protons. This is how our hydrozonium ion is formed, water and an hydrogen ion. And what is the meaning of hydrogen ion? You know, when hydrogen is in this state, what is the meaning? It means that hydrogen is atomic number one before, but it has given the one, which means what you are having is hydrogen don't even have any electron again, but it's just having an empty shell. Can you see that? That's the meaning of this. So how will this now, how will they interact and form coordinate covalent bond? Let's look at it. I will do this again so that you understand. You know, we have done for water, which is this H2O here. The H2O here now. I'm repeating it again. So we have oxygen, okay? We have two, okay? We have this, and we have this. So don't forget, hydrogen is coming to bond for water now. It's coming to bond. Can you see that now? So this is the H2O now. Can you see now? And our hydrogen ion is the empty shell. Don't have anything there. It's the empty shell. Don't have anything there. So what happens? You have an empty shell. You don't have electron. So the H2O, which is the water molecule, say, come, I have two lone pairs that you can use. Because how many electrons do you need? The H2O now is asking the hydrogen ion, how many electrons do you need? He said two. So you don't have a problem. Just come with your shell and feel comfortable. Anyway, so this hydrogen empty shell comes and just bring the shell to form this. Can you see that? And that's the difference between your covalent bond and your coordinate covalent bond. Can you see that? Just bringing the shell to shell. And that is how this very particular hydrozonium. So after combination now, this becomes our hydrozonium. I hope you're following. Very quickly again, let's see for ammonium. Ammonium, can we see this? Here now, the interaction will be between ammonia and this. Don't forget the meaning of this, an empty shell. Okay, so let's replicate our ammonia we did the other time. We have done that. Let's replicate it again. You know, we have two, okay, and five. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, so we have three hydrogens coming to say one, coming to say two, coming to say three. It's NH3 itself. Okay? So you have an empty shell of hydrogen. And don't forget, do we have here that shell can stay? Yes. Because you have somebody here, you have an electron. Ammonia say, come, there's an electron here. You don't need to bring your electron. You are hungry, you don't need to bring your food, just bring your spoon. I'm comfortable. I will share with you. And that's the same thing that's happening here. So this all comes with the empty shell. And that gives us our so that is the difference between your electrovalent, your covalent bond and your coordinate covalent bond or your dating bond. That's the difference between them. But the compounds, irrespective of the compound form, they still share similar properties because you are still sharing. Though the condition for the sharing is different, but you are still sharing. I hope you are following. And that's the reason why some of the characteristics of covalent compounds will be they are liquids or gases at room temperature. Yes, like water. Water is liquid at room temperature. Like chlorine is gas, is gaseous at room temperature. So number two, they are non-polar. You can see they are not forming any positive and negative. They are non-polar. And since they are non-polar, most of them will be insoluble in water. Most of them will be insoluble in water, except ones that have hydrogen bonds in them, like you know, like likes of the alcohol group and the rest. So they are insoluble in water, very, very important. And another one is number four, they are bad conductors of heat and electricity. Because they are not polar, they don't have any charge, so they are bad conductors of heat and electricity. Okay, and they have no melting. So all those are characteristics of our coordinate covalent bond. So your covalent bond you share by bringing the same number of electrons, but your coordinate covalent bond is only one of the participating atoms that brings the electron. You just come and share. So we have another example. In fact, coordination compounds are known for coordinate covalent bonds. We have a lot of them. You know, I'll still try and teach that on this particular channel. So we have other examples. You can try that on your own. We have other examples. Like this, this is another covalent bond where you have phosphorus, you know, that's probably 285. Oxygen will be coming, chlorine will be coming, and at the end of the day, they're bonding together. So you can have this as coordinate covalent bond. Yes, you can have this as coordinate covalent bond. Coordination compounds too, like these two, can have coordinate covalent, because that's even why they said they are coordination compounds, because the kind of bonds in coordination compounds are coordinate covalent bonds. So very, very important. I'll try and make another video so that I will explain the remaining thing, but I want us to go and study this very well. You know, you can solve questions based on the kind of bonds that has been explained today. So in another subsequent section on this channel, we're going to be taking the other three. So please, if you are just watching this YouTube channel for the very first time, I urge you to actually subscribe. So thank you and God bless you.